little bit of a technical issue, so bear with me. Nah, this is good. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
So we heard a lot of speakers tonight. I want you to trust me for this part of the journey. Close your eyes, bro. I want you to imagine a Philadelphia where returning citizens' voices and expertise is valued and is utilized to not only develop but to implement reentry programs. I want you to envision a Philadelphia where no longer are the people closer to the problem excluded from the resources and the power needed to create viable solutions.
I want you to imagine a Philadelphia where, in the circles of power, at the tables where decisions are made, only incarcerated people are sitting there, discoursing, discussing, being listened to, and helping to frame and form the policies that affect our everyday lives.
I want you to imagine a Philadelphia in which people are given second, third, 15, and 35 chances to get it right because they're viewed as human beings and not as AS0747. I want you to imagine a Philadelphia where power is shared equally amongst all the citizens, and the full rights and privileges of citizenship is extended to every resident in this city.
I want you to imagine a Philadelphia where the resources are shared with the grassroots organizations that are doing the real work in the community, so that when folks come home and they come to an office and they don't have a trans pass to find a job, or they don't have clothing, or they don't have the tools necessary to qualify for a position, that these grassroots organizations are able to give them a trans pass, write them a check, help them to move forward with the small things in their life that are so essential, because without these small things, their transition cannot move forward.
I want you to imagine Philadelphia where people has more value than properties. Where human lives take front and center in every decision-making process that we engage in, and we trust, value, and respect those people living next door that we normally would not even shake a hand.
Imagine a Philadelphia where our experience is truly valued. So that we aren't just called when there's a panel discussion, or there's a speech to be made, or there's a situation where we need to have a returning citizen up front to validate a program. Imagine a Philadelphia where our voices are truly respected and we are the center of the nation.
Imagine a Philadelphia where the mayor co-governs with returning citizens, or a district attorney creates an office specifically to address the needs of the people that they generally send away to prison. Imagine if returning citizens were allowed to mentor the men and women incarcerated on our state road and fought for their rights and their return and their inclusion in our society. Imagine that.
Imagine if Philadelphia were returning citizens are sent out into the neighborhoods to reduce violence, to mentor, and to create conflict resolution situations among the young men in our society who are propagating this violence. The same young men who call us OGs, who respect us because we did our time. We never snitched. We came home and we are forces in the community. Imagine a drastic drop in violence based upon that solid leadership.
Imagine, if you will, returning citizens enjoying economic empowerment, political empowerment, and social empowerment. What would Philadelphia look like? So My name is Reuben Jones. I'm a former incarcerated person. I spent 15 years in state prison for robbery and aggravated assault. I was released in 2002 and have been home ever since fighting for this entry movement, fighting for social justice issues. My journey has taken me from sitting in a prison cell wondering when would I be released, if I would be released, to going home and eating beans out of a can and peanut butter and jelly and pushing vegetarian beans. It took me to applying for a job that I was turned down for a cleaning porta potties because I had a criminal record. But it also took me to higher education where I obtained a master's degree. It also took me to receive the Presidential Service Award from President Barack Obama. It also took me to Just Leadership, where Glenn Martin has invested in the leadership of returning citizens in the most profound way I've ever experienced. So I'm here today to help you imagine how you can invest in the people in this city to help transform it into the most progressive, restorative justice practice city in the country. And I believe we have the power to do that. Do you? Do you?
My name is John Dyrell, and I spent 25 years in the federal system. Two separate sentences. The first sentence, I did 7.5 on 16, and the last sentence I did 18 flat on 20. I came home in 2009 and began to further my education, achieved my bachelor's degree, I'm working for my master's, and I founded the Center for Returning Citizens because I saw a real lack of respect for only incarcerated people in the current system. During my incarceration, I was blessed to come under the mentorship of Dr. Matula Shakur, the stepfather of Tupac Shakur, who created a circle of consciousness so that any young man, or older guys, anyone who wanted to transform their lives had a foundation, had a vehicle, had a path, had a journey. And all of the things that I have done since I came home in 2009, the roots lie in the work that I did behind the wall. Because that's where the real work is done. That's where so many lifers and long-time prisoners are mentoring people and sending them out into society to succeed, and we do not give enough credit for that. And we do not even recognize that work that is being done.
Absolutely. I spent my 15 years with Cameron outside where we wrote a book. We created a culture awareness program. We created a Black History program. We created a creative writing program. We did an exchange program with our local college. This is the work that we've been doing for 30 years. We didn't just start because, with all due respect, Michelle Alexander wrote a book. We didn't start because Meek Mill's got a 2-4. This work has a history, and our expertise has a value. So when we bring our histories and expertise to the forefront to offer solutions, trust me, we know what works. Who better to tell you how to stay out of prison than four men who stay out of prison? Right? I mean, I'm not that great at math, but it makes sense to me. What I want to say is we talk about three things: political empowerment, economic empowerment, and social empowerment. So I'll start with the economic empowerment through entrepreneurship. And I want to be, this is the part of it, my speech, that the gloves come off. Reentry is awesome. I'll say it again for those who didn't hear me in the back. Reentry is a hustle. We have governments, we have municipalities, we have mayors, we have district attorneys, we have a lot of political entities who decided they know how to run reentry, right? And what they've decided is, let's put in the minimum resources for the maximum output. So even though since the 80s, violent crime has been on the decline in this country, prison industry has exploded. Again, I'm not a mathematician. I kind of barely squeak through, but does that make sense to you? Does it add up to you? So what we want to offer is, you know, most of the men and women who went to prison were hustlers too. I know I've done everything from sold flowers here. Don't believe it. Wash cars, right there, Joe Frazier's jump, Broadway, whatever. Cut grass, shovel snow, pack groceries at the supermarket. So ever since I was this high, I knew how to make a dollar or 15 cents. But we're talking about empowering folks who can't get a job. So we tell them, as Deanna said, you go home, if you don't pay your child support, we're going to lock you up. The trick of it is nobody wants to hire you. So what happens? The man who can't pay child support ends up back in jail, where guess what? He can't pay child support. Again, my math is a little fuzzy, but I'm working on it. So I want you to think about, what does it mean for a person to become an entrepreneur or a business owner? A returning citizen who spent years on the street perfecting his craft with those, you know, street pharmaceutical sales. Entrepreneurship at its best. So we've designed a program called Change the Hustle. So it's a double-edged sword. Yeah, we talk about changing that hustle of re-entry programming. And I love how you alluded to the fact that programs are not effective. They come, they go, they end, they follow the trends. And we got to think more innovatively than that. So we've come up with a redesigned program called Change the Hustle, where we teach men and women how to transfer those street skills to the business world. If you sell drugs on the corner, you know what it is to market your product. You know what it is to do market research. You know what it is distributing a product. You know what it is about managing people. You know how to brand. You know how to create a budget. It may have been used in the wrong field, but the skills are there, and we can teach you how to transfer it to the business world, how to write a business plan, you know, how to create a board, how to get your business license, how to open up that corner store, the barbershop, or whatever. And we believe that when ex-offenders or returning citizens can start businesses, guess what? They'll hire other returning citizens. And that's how we reduce recidivism, because you can bet a dollar to a donut, if we can start 1,000 businesses in Philadelphia with returning citizens, they each hire two people. Help me with the math. How many people is that?
3,000.
Right? So you talk about, you said 3,000 people return to Philadelphia every year? The defense rests.
They're lawyers.
But the sad reality is that we have been pitching Change the Hustle for several years and have not gotten the city of Philadelphia to buy into the concept. Why not? Is it because it's a concept that is projected by returning citizens? Does it have no value because we thought of it? Because we designed the curriculum? So we thought, how can we structure an economic system that works for returning citizens? And we came up with the concept of the village. We often talk about it takes a village to raise a child. But it may take a village to restructure the face of the region. So in North Philadelphia, we're in the process of talking to hard money lenders, appraising buildings, working with the Commerce Department. We have a long-term relationship with the Architectural Department at Philadelphia University, and they've done an incredible amount of work, actually $60,000, $70,000 worth of work to help us fashion the village, which is a vocational educational center to train returning citizens and also the young people in our community who are not going to college. Philadelphia may be a city of eds and meds, but many of our folks do not fit into that paradigm. They need to be trained vocationally. And we wish to invite the building trades into the vocational educational center, so after they complete their training as plumbers, electricians, sheet rockers, sheet metal workers, they can go into apprenticeships in unions and not just have a job, have a career. We want to create a farmer's market similar to the Reading Terminal in the heart of North Philadelphia, because we live in a food desert. And instead of having supermarkets, we have poppy stores. And because the economy of our communities are controlled by races other than ours, which means that our money flows out of our community, which means that our young people don't have locations where they can seek employment. We want to create housing opportunities, because as folks come out of incarceration, first they need housing. If your family lives in public housing in Philadelphia, you can't move them. So many times people are living in rooms while they're trying to help their family, and they have a doubly hard transition. We want to create art centers where music and art and dance are encouraged, because children of incarcerated parents and our young people who are at risk are not receiving this in the high school. All those programs are being cut back. We want to create a self-contained community where we are entrepreneurs, where we are the leaders, where we are the teachers, where we can not only nurture returning citizens coming back into the community, but help their families in holistic ways, because unless you help the families, you cannot help the returning citizens. And we want to create a model that can be replicated over the world.
This village is vitally important because, let's just say you spend 15 years in prison, like somebody you all may know. And you come home and you've done all this personal development work and transformation, and then you return to North Philadelphia and it's besieged with guns, violence, and drugs. When you look at around you, and there's a bunch of abandoned buildings and vacant lots. When you look around, your unemployment is at an all-time high in your community. So what are you returning to? So we don't make the investment in the communities in which the village will by creating employment opportunities, by creating training opportunities, by creating vocational opportunities, and by serving the basic need, right? A supermarket. This is our vision. And the overall vision will encompass years and years of preparation and development in order to really take the city to the front of transformation. But we believe that if we start now, right? You know how you let that laundry pile up? You should have did a couple of days ago, now you have a big bin full of laundry. Okay. We want to empty the basket now. And we want to begin to reinvest in our communities and our men and women return home, which would then lead to political power. They'll be more engaged in the political process. It's hard for people to entertain or be involved when, you know what Maslow said, right? Those basic needs got to be met before you can even think about pursuing, you know, high levels of existence. So we got to be able to provide those basic needs of shelter, food, water, clothing, safety, and security. And we aren't providing. Reentry is not providing that right now. We're shuffling people through, we're counting numbers, we're rubber stamping a certificate, and we're saying be on your way with no real opportunities once you walk out the door. Taking photo ops, not a lot of opportunity. And we want to change that.
So how can we approach the political side? Our idea was to form the Block Party, which stands for Build, Lobby, Organize, Campaign. Because in the city of Philadelphia, there are over 300,000 returning citizens. So our question is, why aren't we running the city? If there's 300,000 people who have the same shared background, the same hopes and dreams, the same aspirations, why aren't they viewing their situation as one that needs to be moved forward together? Yes, darkness descends.
I thought that was the high side. Party's over.
And the Block Party, the power of returning citizens, joining forces with community activists, LGBTQ community, ordinary citizens,
city government,
the city government, was evidenced by the election of Larry Krasner for District Attorney. When the Black Party and Reclaim Philadelphia knocked on 60,000 doors in North Philly and in West Philadelphia and fundamentally changed how criminal justice is going to be administered in the city of Philadelphia. And that's an astounding victory. It's a victory we have to acknowledge. Philadelphia has long been the bastion of the Frank Rizzo, Lynn Abrahams, Seth Williams mentality of criminal justice. We now have a chance to be leaders in holistic criminal justice, and that's a very exciting prospect.
So that's our vision. Will you join us? Cool. Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. The people down the neighborhood. Don't you be up. Don't you be up. Thank you. Thank you.